So welcome to another episode of Last on the Brakes podcast. This time we're welcoming 2024 MotoGP rider Augusto Fernandez, as well as, of course, probably rookie of the year this year. Be quite a situation if you don't end up with that trophy at the end of the year. From, of course, Gas Gas Factory Racing Tech 3. I'm going to use the French name because, you know, French team. How are you? First question. Not just the announcement, but now in Indonesia, new race weekend, already a doubleheader, bit of craziness across those two races. You feeling good?
Yeah, very good. Looking forward to this doubleheader we have, we're facing now. And also this weekend, Mandalika is a track that I like, and I think we can...
It looks like a cool track.
Yeah, it is. It is. It is very cool. And new tarmac, new tires for us, so things to work on, and looking forward to start the weekend and continue with our progression, let's say, and get closer to the top guys. That is the main thing.
Well, I mean, the obvious thing, you're topical, not only because you are a MotoGP rider, of course, but also because we've now had the announcement that you'll be staying in the Premier Class next year with the Gas Gas Tech 3 team as well, and you'll be partnered by Pedro Acosta. Yeah. First of all, for you, I kind of joked earlier and I said I was going to joke about it on here as well. From the outside, you've looked a little stressed for the last few weeks. I think it's been a bit of a pressure cooker situation for a lot of the people involved. You've walked in today already looking like, hi. Yeah. Do you feel a lot better now?
Well, for sure it's a relief now. It's a relief. Yeah. And it hasn't been easy the last... especially a couple of weeks, now I'm very, very happy to continue with them, with the same team, same bike, same people around, because I really, MotoGP is a very tough class, and I really feel like I need at least another year with the same things, same people and same bike to keep growing and keep performing good and get closer to the top guys. That is the main thing. We want to win, but I felt like I need another year to prove that or another year. So super happy with that.
Your rookie year as well is kind of a extra spicy rookie year in many ways, because we've got the sprint.
Yeah.
And then Friday has obviously changed, qualifying now on Saturday morning. Do you think that's made it harder to just make those steps to get that bit closer?
Yeah, could be. I don't know, because I never had the old format in MotoGP, but for sure had to learn everything quicker and without reference from another rookie.
I was going to say, do you think it's kind of nice to be the only rookie, or would you prefer someone?
I think the beginning was very tough because I was the last one for a lot of sessions, and that's hard because you are used to be,
especially when
first.
You're like king of the world.
Yeah, you used to win, and you are going home sad with a third. So being used to that, and then being giving your maximum, and thinking that you're doing a good lap on quali and you are last 1 second off the pace is hard. But then also to compare yourself, well, for everybody.
I was going to say 1 second is not much though, eh?
Yeah, but in today's
now small, is crazy,
yeah, it's a lot. So, but you're comparing yourself with riders with a lot of experience. So that was the toughest part of the season, the first part. But yeah, it made me learn quicker, I think, so that's okay.
I think one thing that's really notable, looking from the outside, is you've not really crashed a lot. Like, you really, I know, sorry.
Don't
oh no, great.
That.
They also decided to warm up some bikes down in pit lane, perfect timing. But no, you've not really crashed a lot. Like, we've seen some rookies, I'm trying to think, maybe Pecco, especially as an example, compared to now with his smooth, bit of a bumpier start. You just kind of like getting those points. I think it was you and Franco Morbidelli for like most of the first race of the season
points,
that always scored on Sunday.
Yeah.
You've not thrown it down the road, and is that your mentality?
Yeah,
what
like,
is it that's...
Somehow I feel like I really need that races, like all the laps possible to get this learning process, to accelerate this learning process. So for sure a crash wasn't helping. So one of the main things for me was to finish all the races.
I think you finished all of them, right? And you missed out on points once?
India.
Yeah.
India. But we had a technical problem. So, but yeah, I felt like to learn everything, to learn how the race goes, to learn how to manage the tires, to learn how to overtake with this bike, everything. I felt like I need the race time, not only the practice, because you learn a lot on practice, you learn a lot on quali, but when you learn the most is on the race. So I've tried, I always give my 100%, but knowing that I need to finish the race.
Within like the sensible limit.
Yeah, so also it's my style, I can lose a lot of confidence with a crash, so I prefer to not crash. So
I mean, it's not a bad plan.
No. So I love myself, so I don't want to get hurt. But it's my style also, but I think for me it's working.
And what's it like then within, obviously, your GasGas, but within the, we don't want to call it KTM brand, because the brand is GasGas.
Pure Mobility.
Within the Pure Mobility Group, exactly. I think you need an AG at the end to be official. Exactly. How is that fitting in there? Obviously, you've got Jack Miller arriving from, I used to say arguably, surely now I'm allowed to say what is currently the best bike on the grid. You have Brad, obviously, pretty incredible journey so far with KTM, but not other experience. And then you've had Paul alongside you this year as well, who had experience of the bike before. Mm. What's it like coming into that environment as a rookie? It's quite an interesting mix of other riders whose feedback you're kind of joining.
Yeah, for me as a rookie, it was the, a perfect team to learn from. Because Jack is coming from a very competitive bike. Brad has a lot of experience with this bike, and I have side of the other part of the box, Paul, with also a lot of experience in MotoGP, also with KTM at the
three
beginning.
Three different bikes now, Paul's ridden.
So, a lot of experience in around me, so a lot of things to learn from. So for me it was perfect, and then I'm still learning from them, of course. And I use all the data but all from all of three to learn things. And
is there any one of them who's like really kind of come in there and tried to be like, don't like take you under your wing? Like, you are an adult MotoGP rider, but you know what I mean.
We riders, you know, so we don't help each other.
Not too much.
No, but we have good relationship with all of three, so I think it's a good team. And then I used maybe Brad when he's faster, Jack when he's faster, Paul when he's faster.
Just look at.
Also them when I'm not always, but sometimes when I'm faster, they use me. So,
I mean, in Le Mans you were, weren't you?
Yeah, in
Le Mans you kicked everyone's ass in the peer and mobility group quartet.
Exactly. So everybody kind of helps each other with data and everything, but of course we want to beat each other as well. So.
Of course. Even when you are the rookie and you know that, you're still the same competitive, like, actually, I will destroy you if this helps me. So talk us through the season then. You said you're last at the start. Mm. That Le Mans race, we have to talk about it because it was pretty incredible. It was one of those where I think everyone watching, obviously we are not biased. There's plenty of fans who will be gunning for you. Fans of, I can't remember who was right behind you, who'll be like, no, get out of the way. But I feel like that was one of those moments where everyone was like, please stay on. This is glorious. Like, just take it. Because it was such a great weekend. You were super fast all the way through, and then that race. How did that feel after that kind of tougher start and going backwards from?
Like, in Le Mans, I was fast from the first lap. Like, obviously, I won last year in Le Mans with the Moto2. I've always been fast there, so it's a track that I like. But all the weekend also was a surprise for everybody, you know, even for myself, to be competitive, or that competitive from the beginning. And because obviously every Friday is the toughest day for me this season, because I'm kind of learning the track this day, because with the MotoGP is everything different. So you arrive at another speed to the corners and everything feels different, like a new track. So, but yeah, in Le Mans since the beginning was good. I was fast, I was riding well. And we could work a lot from the beginning for quali, for not changing the bike. And,
so it's almost like you started off.
I started on the pace.
Yeah.
I started on the pace, so that helped all the weekend. Then I could focus on quali, I could focus on race pace. So we worked for the race for Sunday to stay on that group for since Friday. So that was the difference. And also quali, I qualified in 12th, I think. So this year, and
you were 3 to Q2, right?
I was in Q1, but then I went through.
Yeah, Q2. But then you went through. Yeah.
So, being in Q2 in MotoGP is it changed all the weekend. Then races, you start from from even in 12, you start already from a very good position to then have a good race, because it's very tough on the back to overtake and everything. Even if you have the pace, it's very different. But yeah, this weekend was perfect, and I could stay there with the group, learn a lot, and enjoy a lot of the race.
So since then, what more have you learned? Because we obviously, we've asked you, I think, in testing when you first got on the bike, oh, what's the difference between this and a Moto2 bike? But what is, like, over the course of the year now, as you're learning more and more and more, like you said, braking markers all completely different, the speed's different, but what are the main things you've learned with the experience so far?
Well, the first thing, after Le Mans, that maybe you think you have arrived, not to be top rider in MotoGP, then you start another weekend and boom, you're last again. So
I think Jack said this in the podcast, where he's like, you can't go into anything being like, oh yeah,
exactly.
You've got to be like,
Even now, them also, like, you need to start the weekend open mind to everything, not thinking that you're gonna be there, or even you're gonna be that. No, so. But prepare for everything, and this is a big thing that I've learned after Le Mans, you know, that every weekend we start from zero and we need to build. So, but yeah.
How do you deal with that mentally?
Well, it's tough, but...
it's just calm.
Yeah, try to get the balance. Don't get too excited when things are going well, and don't get too...
But you got to also celebrate hard when you need to. Come on.
Yeah, of course, but just for Sunday afternoon, you celebrate after the race, and then on Monday you go back to work and prepare the next race, because you can be last again. So you need to find the balance.
Well, you're definitely not last now, certainly. We've made some good progress now. But as you said then, looking ahead to next season, not only relief, now a bit more relaxed, you know what you're doing next year. Mm. What are your kind of thoughts now on... You're going to be the guy with the experience
in the box.
and you're going to welcome back your dear friend who made life complicated for you at the end of Moto2. And you're going to fight over the number again. We'll have a nice fun question about that at the end. But what are your thoughts on that? It's quite a lineup.
Yeah, I think it's a very good team. Well, I'm the experienced one in the box, yes, but luckily we have the KTM official team too, because I need to learn a lot of
You're
things
like,
here, so I'm not.
Still.
yeah. So, but yeah, obviously happy for him, because he deserves to be there, and yeah, I expect him to be a pain in the ass since the very first day in Valencia, because he was in Moto2 since the very first test. He was already faster than me. So
was that the first time you'd really met him properly in Moto2?
Yes.
Because obviously he'd been around, but it was a
I knew about him.
I knew.
Normally, you know about the skis when you.
I knew about him.
Of course. But yeah, I already knew that he was talented and he could be fast on a Moto2, because the way he was riding the Moto3, it could fit with the Moto2, and it did. And I feel the same for him with the MotoGP. So I expect him to be fast since the first day.
It's going to be
Let's
exciting.
See. Yeah.
And what about sharing the box then? Because also you've had a bit of a strange season this year, because obviously Paul, unfortunately, with that crash first time out, you then had Jonas for a while, then you've had Paul back again, but it's a little bit weird kind of having that situation, I guess, alongside you as well. Losing the experience of Paul, also obviously personally difficult thing for him to go through and then come back, everything. But with Pedro, how are you ready for that amount of like firework chispa?
Yeah.
Coming into work every day, being like, "Let's go."
Yeah. I had this chispa. I had it in Moto2 all the year, and we share a lot of moments in Moto2. So yeah, as I said, I'm happy to share the box again with him, and fight for our position on track. Because like in Moto2, we didn't know we have a good relationship, but we want to beat each other on track. So same.
So you're not of the pretend to be immediate best friends and then destroy his life secretly later to get the upper hand type.
I'm quite natural, so I don't pretend
you
to
destroy.
So I will be the same.
Earlier.
I'll try to be the same.
Like we can all tell you've been stressed because your hellos have gone from hi to hi.
So, yeah, whatever happens to me, you can see.
You can chill, always. So. But on that note though, last time you were on, was it last year in Metegi, I think. I remember the press conference. You're on the podcast.
Yeah.
And we talked about your kind of history as a rider getting here. At that time, it was like, oh, and now you're going to go to MotoGP. Mm-hmm. Now you're here. How does it feel? Can you explain to people a little bit your Sev, end of the road, looks like now we're going to have to give up, and now you're a MotoGP rider? Sorry, junior GP officially now.
Yeah.
I need to report myself to myself.
Yeah, as I said last year, like, because obviously also last year the feelings at that point, we were fighting for a championship, and at the end we get it, but we got it.
Yeah, that's true, we didn't do the update.
Yeah. But also at that time, like, coming from the junior GP and all the moments we've been through, and being at that time fighting for a championship, and then now I'm world champion, and then now I'm here with in MotoGP, improving, and with another contract for next year. So I mean, super happy with the journey, with everything I've been through, and all the problems I had in the past, and how we went through all of them, and how we.
Because you kind of made this happen for yourself, didn't you?
Exactly, like family effort, and we've always been together, and being now a MotoGP rider, it's unbelievable. So
I think when we had Joan Mir on before, he was one saying, basically, like, and you'll see it in the Moto3 Junior World Championship, when he was in, it's like 25-0, 25-0, 25-0, because he's like, had to win, because like, it was just me. So it's like, if I don't win, then I don't have the chance to show what I've got, and then get another offer, and
it's like that.
It's almost like there's so many great Spanish riders now. It's almost harder. Everyone thinks it's easier, but there's so many.
It is, because everyone's good. So you need to win, you need to perform, and you need to show the teams that you are better than the other one, because if you are not really better, you need to be the best, because if not, there's another one, because we have a lot of Spanish riders here, no? So it's too many.
It's awful.
So we don't need them, no?
No, what they need from you, though, is English lessons, because you absolutely, that is one thing where you are 100% number one, completely unchallenged among all Spanish riders.
Yeah.
Like, I can speak to you normally, and I do. Some people I do not try in English, because it's just like, no.
Well, thank you. I've learned here in the paddock, so.
Really?
Yeah.
But I think you speak
listening
better English.
You guys,
than...
and of course I try to. I had it as a.
Like at school, as
like. Yeah, I need to focus on this thing, because I feel it's very important. But just learn here in the paddock.
Tell them.
Yeah, tell them.
No, I say it with absolute love, and I feel like possibly I'm allowed to say it slightly more because I do speak Spanish.
Yeah, you are.
Some of my colleagues maybe have less right to complain when they're like, yes, cerveza.
It's very good Spanish, actually.
It's not so bad, right? Not so bad. Right, so we do have a few fun questions, like I said. I want to start with, we're not going to go boom, 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 quick fire, because I want to start with the first, don't be afraid. No, these are genuinely, really, it's fine. But the first one, as I teased when you came in, don't know what this username is, but I'm going to try. Figol Marsha. These are all from Instagram. Who will use the number 37 next season? There's three parts to it. Let's do part one. Who will use it?
Me.
I'm guessing you're not going to give it up, right? The first tally, 1 point for me.
That's fine.
You took it. So, and then will you fight for it? You can't really, can you?
Don't need.
Because if you've already got it, that's the rule,
exactly,
isn't it?
I don't need to fight.
So you'll keep it. We were saying, who do you think would win in a fight between Michele Pirro and Pedro if they fought over the 51?
I go to Pedro.
Yeah, same. No hate for Michele. Just Pedro. Pedro is a terrier. So the next one, we're going from racingness to Indonesia, because obviously they're crazy about MotoGP here. In fact, before we do the fun question, have you felt the love?
Yeah, a lot.
This season, is it more than in Moto2? Can you feel the?
Yes.
Because now you're like properly.
Also, last year in Moto2, when we came here, was at the beginning of the season, so I wasn't.
Oh yeah, true. Yeah,
fighting before for championship.
You were properly,
was the first part of the season, so anybody was. But now,
And now it's like 5 degrees cooler this year as well. This time of year, I'm like.
You're there.
You saw me fight in the shine, so I need it. So from Fiarger _, try my best. Your favorite Indonesian food?
Nasi goreng.
I was like, do you know any?
Yesterday I didn't actually go in.
Really. I had too much last week and now I'm too like, but now I'm like the terrible European person who's like, can I just have carbonara? I've done like more than
a week. We miss our thing, so
sorry. Now I'm just like, I'm sorry. So the next one is from Else Uniska. What would you do if you weren't a rider? It's one of the classic questions we used to get from the MotoGP press conference as well.
Never thought about it.
Well, think about it now.
So something about sports, because I love...
Something about sports, specific.
Sure. Yeah, anything, because I love training. Apart from riding motorbikes, I love running, I love cycling, I love going to the gym. So I love my nutrition, so I love everything involved sports, but really deep into it. So. Sure, something about that, I don't know.
Something about sports.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Makes sense, isn't it?
No, for sure. And then, what is your favourite moment of this season? Is from Evelyn X12. I think...
Favourite moment of the season? Could be Le Mans.
Yeah, no? I think I ruined that question.
Yeah, but also this last part of the season, like, I feel like I'm... Because Le Mans was like... How we did that. Like,
now have you figured that out?
Now I'm feeling like I'm getting closer, but knowing why I'm riding fast, knowing when I do the lap time, why.
And what is it? When you say like, yeah, I look at their data, I do this and this, like how does it actually work when you're sat there?
Yeah, I don't know.
Because
I just feel it.
Just feel
but,
it.
But yeah, it's like that. In Le Mans was, as I said, since the beginning I was fast, so everything was just rolling and then we finished fourth and was unbelievable, but.
But in when you look at data, what does it tell you? Is it telling you where they're braking, where they're opening the gas, like all of this?
Yeah, all of this.
It's just literally like a roadmap, right?
Yeah.
Of someone's lap.
Yeah, everything. Everything. Things you,
and
a lot of things, so many things.
Have you used any, what setup did you start the season with?
Yeah, and also that is very different compared to what I'm using now. So it's like my setup, because also my riding has changed, as I said at the beginning of the season, and I needed to change some things about my riding for the MotoGP, but also for the how the KTM needs to be right. Like if you see when Brad or Jack, how they are riding, they are going sideways everywhere and quite aggressive, and I'm not that kind
of
rider.
Is that a really good meme of the bus going sideways and it's just like Brad Binder?
Exactly. So I didn't have this and I don't have this kind of riding style, but I had to go to this kind of riding style. I'm not there yet, but I'm arriving. So also the bike changed with my style all the way through all the season and every race. But yeah, I feel now more conscious of what I'm doing, how I'm riding the bike, and when I'm fast, why I'm fast, and everything. So I'm happier about my weekend in Japan or my weekend in India, even if I didn't finish the race, than in Le Mans. So I'm happier now than at that time.
Because
I feel like I'm arriving now, not at that time.
And then the other question then, with setups and stuff. Obviously, KTM. Mm-hmm. Sorry to Gas.
Yeah.
The RC16, let's go there. There we go. In pre-season, it was a bit, kind of on the timesheets compared to, especially the last couple of seasons. I think not, there was worry, because I don't think that's fair, because especially the debriefs and what the riders were saying to like Simon Crafar, who was in pit lane for us there, and everyone else was super consistent. It's like, no, it'll all come together. But it was like 17th, 18th, quite a way back.
Yeah.
And then there's been this massive change now. That kind of high point, incredible race in Jerez for the two guys at the front. It was just like, oh, they're here now. Mm-hmm. But what is it like being kind of on that journey as a rookie? Because they're putting all these things together and then you're trying to already put MotoGP together.
Yeah.
And then adding all this new information week on week as well.
Yeah. Obviously, I'm a step back from all these the official movements and what they do on the official team. I'm a step back, but also I'm following when things are working. I'm following. But what I really like, even if we are not there yet, as a KTM, our Gas or
Hero
Pure Mobility
Group AG.
but I really feel and what I really love from the from all the family is that they really want to win. So I'm 100% sure that we are going to be the best bike on track. So that's why I'm also very happy to continue my journey with them, because my dream is to continue all my career with KTM if I can, because I really feel that they need to win. So they really
They've
want to win.
They've certainly put so, they will, so much in.
They are putting all the effort there and changing things, bringing new things, bringing new bikes, new frames, everything, but just trying to win and to be the best bike. So yeah, happy to be part of it. And in the future, if my dream is to stay here and be part of the official team. So and if I'm able to win with them. So riders, we want to win, but they really want to win, so that's nice.
And how, compared to like when you're a kid or a younger rider and you're coming up, obviously KTM weren't really in the premier class then, how is it now kind of seeing them from that perspective of a fan? Because you were watching when it was a completely different era, and then they've come in the last few years and just gone bang, hello, we're here.
Yeah.
It's impressive, no?
Like. Yeah, it's impressive, of course. But in off-road, they've been the kings of every class in off-road, and they're still being the kings. So they want to be the kings also here. And also, they had in their MotoGP careers, they had up and downs, because in 2020 they had a really good season.
Yeah, and then a bit.
So they
of
were almost there, then a little bit down. So they also been they had a tough moments. But it's coming. From my side as a rider, and also from their side as a bike and building all the new things, it's coming our moment.
I'm confident it is.
Yeah.
So then another one about kind of the past and looking at it now. Dani Pedrosa, mm-hmm. MotoGP legend, now KTM test rider. Have you had much kind of work with Dani, and how is that for you? I imagine being a Spanish rider when he was really at the top, it must be something quite cool, no?
Yeah, it's incredible. Already, I remember in Malaysia Shakedown when I was the first time sharing the track with him, and sitting at looking at the data with him and having a chat and asking him questions and then seeing him on the track. Yes, it's unbelievable. It's a dream.
He's not doing a bad job either, eh?
And even though. So it's impressive how he rides. It's very nice. And when we talk about data, when you see Danny's data, it's incredible. So it's very clean and precise, and it's Dani, as always. Right? And, it's very, very nice to
cool?
share team with him.
It seems like a cool experience.
Yeah.
I mean, we just loved it. I think I speak for everyone.
The
fact that he's done wildcards, great.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
The fact that he's also done wildcards and been like, remember me?
You can't hate that. So,
it's so good.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
been great to watch. But okay then, so looking ahead to the next few races, we've got 6 left, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, including this weekend. So those of you who are listening straight away, well done, you'll get that. How are you feeling about the next few? Have you got any targets to sort of end the year with? Obviously getting closer, putting those weekends together, of course.
Yeah, do you mean about a podium, of course.
Shock, come back to take the title. But yeah,
Let's start with the podium. No, obviously, I think our real place is to secure myself and ourselves on the top 10. Because we've been...
On Sunday? Both?
No.
Sunday?
Sunday, of course, is the main thing. But I need to improve the qualities, need to improve Fridays.
I was going to say, I thought you'd take you too.
Finishing the year with... better weekends overall, being competitive since first day, more Q2s, because then maybe Sunday, now is the top 10, starting from 17, 18, but starting from 10 could be another thing. So, because pace is already good,
yeah.
I always come up good on the end of the races. So yeah, main thing is to secure ourselves in top 10, Sundays, but also qualies and everything.
Cool, well. We'll see.
And a podium.
And a podium, of course. And obviously the crown.
Yeah.
No, I love it how everyone's just like, yeah, just this. It's like, yeah, but, you know.
Yeah,
no, but no, well, thank you so much for talking to us. I think we covered everything. We've voted for Pedro in the Pedro Pirro SmackDown event of the season next year, you're definitely going to keep the number 37.
Yeah.
I think it would be a psychologically interesting decision if you gave it to him. So I could see that. And best of luck for the rest of the year.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for joining us. And hope everyone enjoyed this episode.